May I request all of you to kindly settle down and be seated, please? We are about to begin the next session, which is on sports as a catalyst to building a new India. We are about to begin. Our distinguished panelists are here. I'd like to welcome our distinguished panelists, Shri Kirti Azad, Honorable Member of Parliament, Mr. Geet Sethi, Mr. Deepak Jacob, Mr. Manavjit Sandhu, Mr. Vikrant Gupta, Ms. Vidya Shah, and Ms. Shabnam Panjwani, the session moderator. Please join us on the dais, and I would like to request all the distinguished delegates to kindly be seated so that we can start the proceedings right away. Thank you so much. A warm welcome to you all the distinguished panelists. Thank you very much for kindly joining us. And I have no doubt with such a powerful and interesting panel, it's going to be an exciting session. So without further ado, I'd like to just turn it over to session moderator, Ms. Shabnam Panjwani. She's from Edelweiss. Please take it over. Thank you.
Thank you, Manav. Good afternoon, everybody. Padhoge, likhoge, to banoge nawab. Kheloge, kudoge, to banoge kharab. We've all heard this, right? This is sort of how sports, or bar, khel, kud, was always treated when we were young. And some parents here would probably be doing the same with their kids, now. But there's another way of looking at this. These are famous words from an amazing personality, Nelson Mandela. And what he said, sport has the power to change the world. It has the power to unite in a way little else does. It speaks to youth in a language they can understand. Sport can create hope where there was only despair. It is more powerful than governments breaking down racial barriers, and it laughs at all kinds of racial discrimination. That was Nelson Mandela. And that is sport. And it is not kharab. So today, we have an amazing panel here. And this, I'm hoping, will be 30 minutes of great opinions, great views. We would like to really talk about four areas. And back to building a new India, can sport be a catalyst in both mindset, economic development, social development, and particularly in women empowerment? Of course, a lot of media and entertainment consumption and investments. And we will spend a little time on that. We know that the execution of a mega sporting event in the country. I mean, you can look at what's happening in Orissa right now with the World Hockey Cup, both in terms of developing infrastructure, generating employment, bringing in tourism. All of this contributes significantly to the bottom line. In Orissa, 2016-17, the government spent 60 crores in sports development and infrastructure. This year, it is a nice, hefty 350 crores already. And I'm assuming that is also reflected in a higher employment and revenue generation. One of the largest industries globally in terms of employment and revenue is supposed to be sports. In developed countries, it generates 2 to 4% of total employment. In India, it is 0.05%. And we haven't even yet begun. When we look at media, for example, one of the key parameters to look at, you know, how whether sports is progressing in our country, etc., is to see how media and viewership numbers will increase. And of course, we have Deepak here who will throw further light in that matter. But the Asian Games is viewed by 11.2 crore people. 80 lakh views daily for 2 weeks straight. This is three times higher the number of views than the last Asian Games edition. We also all know, and we talk about it, that exposure to sports also changes our mindsets. We've talked about character building, we talked about understanding fear of failure, the ability to build competitiveness within ourselves. But at a sheer socio-economic space, look at what's happening in Haryana. Rani Rampal, Fogart sisters, ladies where from womb to adulthood, women were probably seen to be chattel and reasons for female feticide. But these ladies, each time they come on the cover of the Times of India and the Indian Express and the Hindu and is beamed live by the star sports of the world, creates within the system more and more people to go out there and help those ladies and more younger women coming into play. So that's fairly catalytic. I will now shut up because there's such amazing people sitting right here. And if we can all start by first conversation with you, sir. There's the mic.
Hello?
Yeah. Sir, we all know the gentleman who brought the Prudential World Cup 1983 and three-time MP. And as a sports practitioner, and now in the role of an enabler, it would be wonderful to hear your views on how you saw sports then. What do you see happening now in terms of your own individual space? Because I think when we want to go change the future, we need to look at a quick peek at the past. So if we can have your view, please.
Well, good evening, everyone. I must tell you, I may be a politician, but I'm a sportsman at heart and a politician by choice. So I've always loved to be a sportsman. A sportsperson does not belong to any caste, creed, religion, region. He belongs to his team. He belongs to his country. And that gives me the greatest pleasure. Being a politician, then obviously, there are so many considerations of which caste you belong to, which area you come from, which area you can fit in, where you can contest elections from. So I would say that there is a lot of politics in sports. I only wish there was sportsmanship in politics. We would have been a better country. I don't mean to say that we're not a better country. It's how we feel within ourselves. Well, talking about a game, how it was in the past and how it is now, I think game is exactly the same. You pick up any game with what Geet plays, you Manajit plays, or anybody else plays. The game is exactly the same. A few changes here and there might have taken place. It's the attitude which has changed over the years. A lot of money has come into the game. But I can say it's only in a few games where you have IPLs or EPLs or BPLs. Apart from that, the game has been exactly the same. The associations and federations have been exactly the same. Sportspersons have been exploited, were exploited then, are exploited now. And we need people like you to come in. And I have a lot of ideas how you can contribute by not only just giving endorsements or sponsoring events, but you could do that, change it, change the lives of sportspersons who give everything for this country. And I have a lot of idea, and as Shabnam asked questions, I would speak. I won't take much time. I know there's only half an hour that we have. But I feel the game has not changed. A few rules might have changed. But the associations and federations are exactly the same. They haven't changed. And every single post, 99% of them has a politician sitting there as a president, either at the center or at the state. And I fail to understand. I, being a sportsman myself and a politician, I don't get time to go and sit with Vikrant in his Aaj Tak studio and do expert commenting. I fail to understand how a person being a full-time politician can give 365 days to a sports federation.
I think there are quite a few corporates and industrialists here, Kirti. We must have an offline with Kirti because his ideas are actually quite inspiring and very actionable. So yes, Kirti, we'll come back to some more questions and answers. Geet, world billiards champion, I think the Khel Ratna Award and innumerable accolades to your name. You are also part of a movement that has truly built immense confidence in sports persons, the ability to win medals, which is with Olympic Gold Quest. In your view, what is the single most enabling aspect of sports today in this generation that you are seeing, having been at OJK for over a decade, that you think will help us go ahead? And the second question is, what is the single largest obstacle that is going to pull us back?
Good evening, everybody. First of all, I'm presuming that building a new India, I'm presuming that we qualified by saying we're building a energetic, vibrant, and world-class new India. Yeah, I'm presuming that. So when one translates that into sport, I have slightly different view from my honored friend and fellow sportsperson. I have been a great cribber. I have been one of the most vociferous critics of federations and of government way back in 98. And I cribbed so much that I became so despondent and I said, if nothing's going to change, what can I do in my individual capacity to make a small change? And that's how Olympic Gold Quest was born. Having said that, in the last 10 years, I have seen a dramatic shift in the whole ecosystem of sport. Yes, the federation part perhaps is still a little stagnant, but the overall sentiment of sport in India, be it the corporates, be it the sports people, be it the political will of government to spend money, and it's not just this government, I think the previous government, it started with the previous government, it started 10, 12, 14 years back. And suddenly we have seen that there is an energetic India, there is a confident India, there is a sports people in India today are not despondent. In 98, we used to say, can we win one medal? Today, every athlete who goes to the Olympics is saying, I want to come back with a medal. And I think that's the shift. And that's the subconscious confidence that has been slowly built up. If you asked me the first question as to what is the
single most electrifying thing that you think is going to change?
Single most in sport?
Yes, and take us all the way
up. I think what's going to change is that federations are not going to work on their own. A PT Usha is not going to run on her own on her beach with a coach, and government is not going to just come up with schemes on their own aloof. I think, and then there are not-for-profits who are also not going to just work on their own, saying that this athlete needs support and here we are supporting an athlete. I think we have reached this stage where all of us are going to work together, and that is going to be the winning formula. I have great hope, and I am really, really an optimist today that we will become world class. We will come back with 20 medal, Olympic medals in 28. I am really, really convinced about that. And in an eco environment where shooting, boxing, wrestling, badminton, and archery, these are our core sports where we have done traditionally very, very well in Olympic sport. I have no doubt that we will come back with 20 medals in 28. The whole environment is because we will be working together. How has this happened? It's happened because of everybody's inputs. Everybody's inputs. Government's inputs, the not-for-profits inputs, federations are easing up, the athletes are And finally, who's the stakeholder? The stakeholder is the athlete. The stakeholder is finally actually that medal. So that was the answer to their first question. The second?
And the second is, what is the obstacle? What is going to happen or not happen to not or allow us not to reach where we want?
I wouldn't call it an obstacle. I think we need huge funding. there is a direct link between money and performance in sport. There is a direct link between how much money a nation spends into sport and the number of medals that come. So I think we need to loosen our purse strings. I think successive governments have realized that. So from a sports budget of 150 crores in 98, we have now reached 2000 crore. We need 10,000 crore, but that's okay. And I think this is where, again, it's not just government that needs to put in the money. I think private enterprise needs to put in the money. There is CSR. Of course, India is such a varied country with so many problems. By all means, spend 98% of that CSR into all the problematic areas. But do spend 2% of your CSR budget on sport. Because sport finally is about pride. An Olympic medal represents pride, not pride only of that athlete who stands on the victory stand. And when the national flag goes up, if it's a gold medal and the national anthem is played, each and every one of us feel that pride. We participate in the pride. And therefore, sport instills this very collective spirit of feel good and spirit of coming, you know, together or coming into being a nation which is world class. So really, money is the obstacle. Of course, managing that money is another challenge. It's not just the money, but predominantly we need big money to get big medals and to really become to have infrastructure across mofussil areas so that everyone can play. We need big money in infrastructure, and we need big money to fine-tune our elite athletes. An elite athlete may require 5 crores every year just to see that his or her potential is fulfilled. So really, that's the obstacle.
Thank you, Geet, Kirti. Most accomplished sports persons have given a view of what was before and their hopes of the future. Manavji, number one in the world in trap shooting, Khel Ratna winner and four-time Olympian. You also have family, father, also an Olympian, and probably a house and an ecosystem that gave you the kind of support you required to get where you went and are going to continue to go. Can you elaborate on that support? What if it was not that kind of an ecosystem? Where would you have been? Would you have done what you did today?
No, absolutely not, Shabnam. You know, it's interesting you mentioned that. If you look at all our traditional medal winners, they've all come from sporting families, which is something we're proud of. But it's also, if you must take it negatively, why is it that we don't get a winner from outside a sporting environment? Why is it we don't get a doctor's son who decides not to become a doctor, but just take up sport and then really do well? Because there was just no widespread government support. It's not there at the grassroots level. Now, for example, in my event, in shooting, getting a gun is a huge challenge. Then you need ammunition for that gun. And then you need a shooting range to practice on. I had my father, we were brought up in Chandigarh. He relocated me to New Delhi because the shooting range here was better. So these are sacrifices a sporting family does. But to expect an engineer's family to say, okay, now we're going to shut shop and take my son to a good academy where different city perhaps may be a long shot. So what we need to do is we need to make sure that the facilities are around wherever the talent is, and then the talent gets involved by watching people like us who have, you know, gone against the odds and won something. So they look at us, they get inspired, and then they say, okay, we're going to take this up. And of course, like Geet said, at the end it all boils down to money in a way, because you need to have financial security. No sportsman gets into sports wanting to be a multimillionaire. That's not so. Money sometimes, you know, you take the wrong connotation that you just want to get rich. Not at all. It's not a question of rich. If you want to get rich, you'd probably be an industrialist. What you want to do is have a sense of security of job. You know, everybody's worried about that. You don't need to make millions, but you need to have enough so you can have a good quality of life and bring up your family. And so for that, we need to create an environment where you sort of guarantee that, look, if you take sports and you do reasonably well, you'll be looked after as much as you would be if you're maybe a doctor or a teacher or any of the other honorable, so for our traditional career routes. So the moment sports becomes a career route, we'll find parents much, much, much more conducive to putting them into sport. In my case, I was lucky. My father was a shooter. If he hadn't been, I think I would have definitely not been a shooter. I don't see myself as one-tenth of what I did if my dad hadn't been a sportsman. So this is something we must take away. We must bring non-traditional sporting families into the sporting fold.
Thank you, Manavji. We're so glad that you've had the support and therefore you have brought in the medals that lets India shine. But talking about support, Vidya, CEO of Edelgave Foundation, and Edelgave currently has impacted about 1.5 billion in investments, about 150 NGO partners, and was one of the first funding partners with OGQ. My question to you was, way back, probably in 2008, 2009, when maybe Mary Kom and P.V. Sindhu and Ayanika Paul were probably not names known, what is it that drove you to move in the direction that you did in terms of philanthropy and partnership with OGQ?
Actually, giving a grant to OGQ was not easy. We loved the story. We loved the model. It was pretty much ahead of its time. OGQ was still a very young organization. Mission, the ideals that with which OGQ was formed were absolutely marvelous, especially with Geet and Prakash at the helm. But like a traditional foundation, we had focus areas. We had education, we had women's empowerment and livelihoods. And internally, the questioning was, you know, by working in the area of sport, aren't you sort of deviating and this is just going to create challenges? And I'm sure a lot of CSR houses face the same challenges. We're asked to focus. But the model was very, very compelling. It was very powerful. And we did believe that this was another way of looking at, building the pride of the nation, creating, a sporting culture in the country. The compromise we made, in a sense, and I'm so happy we made that compromise at that time, was to say that we'd only support women athletes. And we said that that way we won't be deviating too much and we would still be participating in this fascinating journey. And so right from 2009-10, which was the first year of support, and we've been with OGQ through that entire journey, we've seen, we chose women athletes, worked with Geet's team, worked with Viren, the CEO, and found some absolutely exciting young girls and women that we consistently provided support to. So at a time when Mary Kom was not known, we started, our first funding was actually to Mary Kom. Sindhu was about 15, I think, when we first started supporting her. And I think it's role models like Mary Kom and Sindhu have, and Saina and a whole host of Sania Mirza, all of them have actually emboldened a whole generation of girls to look at sport as a serious profession. And the example that you quoted earlier, the girls from Haryana, a state with the worst gender sex ratio in the country, has seen the highest number of women athletes. It's such a strange phenomenon. But I think the fact that we supported women has really enabled us to look at what are the other means of empowering women and girls in the country. And sport has turned out to be one of the best ways of doing it.
Thank you, Vidya. One of the things that I've always remembered is when someone told me that if you're talking to an audience of about 200, 300 people, ask the men there how many of them, when they were kids, come back home from school, would drop their satchel, and mother would say, "Abe, beta, jao, khelne ko." And the same men, if they had sisters who would come home, she wouldn't drop the satchel in the first place, but andar jaake thori roti bana do bhai ke liye. And I think that's one of the great reasons why, if we focused on women empowerment and having the sports as a leading change enabler for these women, it's after years of not having done that. But now, coming to Vikrant, a sports editor of Aaj Tak, he runs one of the highest watched sports and cricket show, also has been labeled the best sports anchor of the country. So the question I'd really want to ask you is, yes, I'm sure you have every single cricket statistic at the tip of your fingertips. The role that media plays, and more whenever there is a win, when there is a defeat, when it is about talking about sports and how it changes mindsets, how do you as Aaj Tak, because you have a very, very large reach, how can you change mindsets besides just telecasting or broadcasting shows?
See, first of all, we need to understand that India is not a sports-loving country. There's this myth that India is a cricket-loving country. It's not a cricket-loving country as well. If there's a Ranji Trophy game going on in Delhi, nobody will go and watch it. India is a cricketer-loving country. Or in other sports, if there are icons, like you said, Saina, Sanya, Sindhu, Geet, then people will go and watch them. You spoke about the fact that in earlier times, you know, parents would say, beta, jao jaakar khelo. It happened with me. I want my sons to play. They play fair, decently well in cricket. When they come back home, they've got to go to the tuitions because there is this peer pressure. So what is it that India has done? 1983, when India won the World Cup, I still remember 80,000 people would go and watch test match. The BCCI did not have money to award the players. Lata Mangeshkar, the great Lata Mangeshkar, held a concert and the players were awarded money. Today, the BCCI has enough money. Maybe the intent has changed. Fact is that sports should be about sportspersons, not sporting federations. Unfortunately, not just Aaj Tak. You look at the mainstream national newspapers. Front page stories invariably would be about the federations and the officials. It will not be about any sporting achievement. You would read about the Lodha Commission, about the BCCI's infighting and all those things. It will not be about Manav, Jeet, Geet, Sethi, Kirti, Azad anymore. What I feel is, because when I was growing up, India won a gold medal in 1980 at the Moscow Olympics. And as a kid, I had to wait 16 years for another medal, which came in 1996. Yes, we had the 1983 World Cup. We had Geet, Sethi becoming the world champion. Manav, Jeet probably is my age. But fact is, 1996, so we had to wait 3 more Olympic Games for one medal. And if you had 6 in 2012, it means that, you know, organizations like OGQ, for example, they've done well. They've groomed youngsters, they've groomed sportspersons, they've groomed champions. But the intent has to come from the government. It cannot just be boxing hai to Bhiwani se aajayega, badminton hai to Gopi kar dega, that's it. How many team events have done well internationally? You will have shooters doing well, you will have boxers doing well, you will have individual players, maybe not because of the system, in spite of the system. I would, maybe Geet may or may not want to elaborate on that. Do they get the right kind of support that they want from the federations? Do they get the right kind of support that they want from the government? Is the intent there? You know, Deepak would vouch for it. A star has so many leagues, they estimate in so many leagues. There's this Kabaddi League, where players who were unknown, Mofussil, they are millionaires now. But is there an infighting between the Kabaddi federations? Are they also not looking at the glamour? What happened with the BCCI? I think, to my mind, I was a youngster, I played for Punjab till the under-19 level, and I know, I can vouch for the fact that cricket in India was the best run. Hockey was a parallel in the mid-80s. We were so good in hockey. 1998, India won a gold medal in the Asian Games, Bangkok. The team lands back. 6 players were sacked. As Aaj Tak, in 2004, before the Olympics, we signed 4 Indian hockey players to be our experts at the Olympics. There was a camp going on at the National Stadium. The media was thrown out. The BCCI, on the other hand, as a federation, did a good job. They got cricket out of the clutches of the British Empire, then cricket became big, television and all those things. And you know, that is why you have people like Virat Kohli and others still playing the game. It's a different matter that Virat comes from Delhi, where playing cricket is the most difficult. But fact is, why could hockey not become cricket? Why is it that the BCCI made cricket the way it is? Yes, it also became a monster for them. Just look at the way the BCCI is being run the last 3 years. There were issues, there were problems, and Kirti Bhai was among the ones who highlighted all the problems within the federation, the BCCI. And then they went to Supreme Court.
In fact, I think we're going to have a conversation on the federation. There's something that we would discuss.
So they went to Supreme Court to investigate match fixing. The match fixing angle never came out. So what the Supreme Court did was they gave the BCCI to somebody else. Rather than running the BCCI, the cricket administrators are busy fighting among themselves. So the problem, as I said, in India is that we are not a sports loving country. We've got to change our mindset. Let my kids play. Let them play. Let the school tell them, don't worry about marks. If you're a good cricketer or a good shooter or a good boxer, we'll invest in you. But that won't happen. My son will start going to the 10th standard and my wife would say, bas abe ek saal cricket nahi khelega. So at 15 or 16, if he doesn't play for 1 year, he's gone. He can only play mere saath for fun's sake. Nothing aside of that. I think so, that is the mindset we need to change.
So let me now get to the one who currently possibly has the maximum influence on mindsets, Deepak Jacob, chairman of the FICCI committee and also star counsel, beams into millions and millions of houses all the time. So let us have your view. I know we talked about FICCI's three pillars, but I think you had also some very interesting information on how and what Star has been doing, not only in terms of as a broadcaster, but also as a sheer partner in infrastructure and ecosystem development to ensure sports and its immersion within the audience is a lot better. So,
thank you, Shabnam. And thank you to all the audience over here. Good evening to all and to my fellow guests. So, I mean, interesting points brought up by Honorable Member of Parliament Kirti Azad and Vikrant and Geet. So before I answer your question, Shabnam, I'd just like to give a point of view on that. Beware of what you ask for when you're asking the government to help you. It's not going to happen, and it's better it doesn't happen. I think whatever the government is doing now with the limited budget that they've allocated to sports is the best left where it is. I think what the government can do probably is introduce a national sports code or a bill to basically create transparency and hygiene in the running of federations. But I think that's where it should stop. And I think the government can run programs like Khelo India, et cetera, which is good. Because if you try and get government involved, they don't have the wherewithal or the resources or the skill sets to be able to run professional leagues and federations, et cetera. And we have learned that by way of example. Pro Kabaddi League was non-existent. I mean, Kabaddi has been the oldest sport in India. 60, 70 years after independence, nobody ever thought of investing in or professionalizing the Kabaddi League. It was just by chance that, you know, Anand Mahindra, who was an entrepreneur, created Mashal, which was the which got the league rights from the federation, and Star invested in that entity to basically take a long-term view of, you know, building that league. And we have had to build it from ground up. There were no Kabaddi stadiums. There were no Kabaddi players were scattered across the country, part of the Railway Protection Force, part of, you know, there were constables in various, you know, Border Protection Force and Haryana Police, etc. We have gone and given them a career. We have gone and given them recognition, and we have changed their lives, and we've also created an entire ecosystem of younger children or Kabaddi athletes who are now are looking towards them as heroes, fundamentally. Now, that we worked on thinking in terms of three pillars. We said sport must be a industry first. If sport is not looked as an industry, nobody is going to invest in it. And that sport must be a career option, as you were saying, for example. What does a kid do after 10th and 12th? He's got to go to university and go get a job. But if there are professional leagues, like in the US, minor league, major leagues, amateur leagues, if there are professional leagues, there is a career pipeline for any kid in this country. And finally, for those of us who are not destined to become professional athletes, sports as a health and well-being proposition. Sports equaling physical fitness, physical activity, mental, physical health, and character building, as you know, Vidya was mentioning, the very important part. It builds character. I think the sports as a health and well-being proposition also must be promoted by whether you're a broadcaster, or whether you're a sports person, or whether you're the corporate industry. If you use these three pillars, you can turn any sporting federation into a success story. It need not be at the scale of a BCCI. I mean, as Vikrant was saying, BCCI has done a fabulous job in this country. There's no doubt about that. It is, and it has done it agnostic of government help. That is a very important factor. They have been able to, it's taken them 25, 30 years to build the kind of value that they have, but they have actually gone and taken cricket to the grassroots level. So while we all love to, you know, whip them every day, and the media just loves whipping them every day, but the fact of the matter is that they have created an ecosystem of cricket, and they're arguably one of the wealthiest bodies in this country. So I think all these three pillars are needed to build the sporting ecosystem in India.
One of the things that we talked about, and it was a very interesting data point that the MP, Mr. Anurag Thakur, gave us yesterday. In Himachal Pradesh, they have a sports program, and when they went, once it was started, they were able to enroll up to 20,000 young men into this particular program, which saw a dramatic reduction in the drug use, and it countered that, which is one of the things that even in that short verse from Nelson Mandela, where bringing sports and having youth have an aspect and a space where they can use their energy and their time in pursuit to make themselves feel better and to stay away from all of this. Is this something that is just, this is of course something that is far beyond medal winning. It is about the mindset. It's about having sports as part of a culture. Vikrant, you talked about saying that we are not a sport loving country. And while we may be a sport medal winning loving country, how do we make it a sport loving country? Like Vidya was saying, like it's in Australia or in America, everyone plays a sport, whether it's basketball, whether it's baseball, that is what you do. We don't. And that changes. Like Kirti sir spoke about right in the beginning, that sport is uniting. There's no race, caste, creed, sex. You don't look at any of that when you're playing. How does that get built up? Of course, infrastructure, of course, ecosystem. But are we all just so academically, you know, focused? Anyone like to ask that question, answer that question?
If I may, I think one of the things that I think to make ourselves more sport loving is to make sport accessible and easy, you know, because in most of our minds, the idea is that sports is only for people who are physically fit, who have a certain genetic makeup, and only those people can really do sport. I think one of the examples I always give is the Mumbai Marathon and the tremendous transformation it made in Mumbai in terms of the focus on fitness. And the thing about the Mumbai Marathon was it was easy. You know, you could do a 5K run and still feel like a big runner at the end of it. And then it started creating a positive spiral movement of saying, okay, if I can walk 5 kilometers, can I run 10 kilometers? And I think that easiness about the whole thing is important. So it's not about sport. It should be about health and fitness, and it should be easy and accessible.
Kirti sir, what would your view be?
See, the first thing is that we must have good infrastructure equally across the country. And if you look at major cities and metropolis, you find that the basic structure is there. I mean, that is why Manavjit had to shift from his native place, come into Delhi to train here, because facilities were better here. secondly, he had a problem buying a gun. because there is no regulation regarding sports in our country. We have on every other thing that you can think of under the sun. But there is no bill, as long as there is no regulatory bill as far as the sports is concerned. And although I was in the opposition, and the then sports minister, Mr. Ajay Makhan, brought in that National Sports Development Bill, we all supported it. But all politicians, cutting across party lines, whether they were in the opposition or in the ruling, they all opposed it, and it never saw the light of day. Until unless you have a regulation, I mean, like you have companies, you have memorandum of association, articles of association, you have a financial manual and you work accordingly. Same way, you need to have regulations as far as sports is concerned. And it has to spread across the country equally. I was talking about, Geet, I think got me wrong. First of all, I was talking about the role of federations. Now tell me, would Geet tell me how federation helped him to become a world champion? Can Manoj tell me how the federation helped him? It was his father who went around. He saw to it, he took care of him. And this is the case as far as 95% of the people are concerned with their sitting there. Thanks to her that she had helped Sindhu and Saina to come up as world champions. Now, where were the federations? I think now you will have to take up the roles. When I said that I have ideas for you to take up the role, how you can do that? Is there a stadiums? You know, they're lying just like that. They have stadiums worth of crores and crores of rupees. Over 1,000 crores is worth of Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium. Go to Shivaji Stadium, it's worth 500 crores. Go to Talcottara Stadium, it's about 900 crores. Go across the country, and these are being used for political functions or film star nights. I mean, can you imagine the state of affairs of sports? My heart bleeds. I think if you have a CSR of, say, 500 crores, and all you got to do is just take out 50 crores, 10% of that. I can make it for you if FICCI wants it. I can give you the idea. You can ask your people. We can go to the government. You go to the government. You are basically the interconnect between the businessmen, companies and the government. I mean, you float it around. You see, I need 50 crores or 55 crores for Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium. Pick up, say, 60, 70, 80, 90 good athletes. Ask the federations to help you, if at all they have good, and they will come up with the genuine students, sports persons, take them up, get them coaches, and that 50 crores would look after the maintenance, have a bilateral, have a triangular, have a quadrangle, Southeast Asian country athletic tournaments. You can do that, you have that money. I do appreciate that you are contributing towards or sponsoring these tournaments, but I feel the basic thing is to go to the brass text, to the grassroots. And from there, we can pick it up. And when Vikrant says that we are not a sporting nation, yes, we are not a sporting nation. We have the winning spirit. We don't have the sportsman spirit. As long as we win, we are happy. We don't win, aisi bekar hai yaar, ye to iska kya karna hai. So I do agree. I appreciate people like Vidya. And here is how you can improve when you talk about it. Is I don't expect anything from federations. I don't expect anything from government. Very rightly said by Deepak. This year's budget has been reduced by 20%, that is 600 crores, as far as the sports budget was concerned. Just giving money to the federations. And what do these politicians do sitting as heads, as presidents and chairman? They run their offices, their kitchen are run because of that. Because they have no financial manual, they have no memorandum of association, articles of association, and they are not accountable. Nobody's asking them questions. And that is the reason why we are not able to bring sports like cricket is popular. That is why the other games are not becoming popular. In cricket, you know, in the next 10 years, what is going to be the fixtures, that which countries are you going to play, when you're going to play Ranji Trophy, who's in which group. But in other games, you don't know. There are no dates are fixed, no tournaments are fixed. You don't know what's happening. Athletes are running without shoes. They're running bare feet.
On
so
that,
this is a very sorry state of affairs. I feel bad. I remember Jaspal Rana, same in the air gun. I ran with him
at least 5 or 6 times to the sports minister. And then he would say, nahi, ye to home dekhenge, then went to home minister. Nahi saab, ye to idhar jana padega, falane ke paas jana padega. Nobody knew. Aray, yaar, ek sportsman ko equipment chahiye. Usko ek choti se bandook chahiye. Wo bhi apne paise se kharid raha hai. Federation se nahi kharid raha. Federation ke paas gaye. Inke federation mein pehle mantri hi the. Naam nahi lunga. Aapke shooting association ke mantri hi the. Achhe khase the. Mere bhi bade achhe mitr the. Unhone ek chitthi likh di mantri ko. आदरणीय मंत्री जी, फलाना हमारे मानवजीत सिंह जी हैं, बहुत ही अच्छे फलाना है, इनको एक बंदूक की आवश्यकता है, आपसे अनुरोध है कि कृपया एक बंदूक के लिए आप अनुमति प्रदान करें। Done and over with, and I ran with Jaspal, and ultimately he cried. He wanted ammunition, pellets. यार उसके लिए भी तंग करोगे यार? So I feel. The way you're doing a yeoman service for the country, by promoting your countries, I urge you today, I beg you, please do come forward and think of it. If one of you cannot do it, 2, 3, 4, 5 people, get a consortium, do it. Take it up.
On that very, very passionate note, we'll open up for a quick one question.
I'll just add to what he said. Aap 10% nahi dijiye, 5% dijiye, 2% dijiye, but dijiye zarur.
Just one point. If
any questions?
If I may, just one point. I'm sorry, you know, the media is accused. And as India Today grow...
I never accused you.
No, people do. As Aaj Tak or whatever, 95% of our programming is only and only cricket, unfortunately. It's not as if we don't want to. I'll give you a very small little example. When Abhinav Bindra won the gold medal, which was India's first individual gold medal in 2008, Aaj Tak's TVR, and we get ratings every week. Aaj Tak's TVR was the highest. We showed the entire ceremony live. Doordarshan did not object to it. The winning moment and the tricolor, everything was live for 1 hour. So we got 175 number. The TVR was 175, which was the number one across the channels. Those times, if India won one ODI against a country like Zimbabwe or Sri Lanka, we would get about 500. If we beat Australia, we would get about 800. If we beat Pakistan, it'll be upwards of 1,000. When India won the World T20 in 2007, we were 2,000. When India won the World Cup in 2011, we were 5,000 versus 175 of Abhinav Bindra.
But sir, it's a chicken and egg situation.
No, the problem is we will do everything. Okay, the problem that channels face vis-a-vis newspapers is that newspapers will have 4 pages. So if you wish, you can read this news, you can flip through. We'll have 15, 20, 30 minutes. We try to squeeze in as much as we can. We do the Olympics, we do the Asian Games, we do World Cup hockey as well. Now, obviously, it is dictated by the TRPs. So what we did was, we have a YouTube channel called Sports Tak. Everybody can subscribe to the channel and just go through it. We do one chat on cricket. I will do one chat on cricket and I'll get 3 lakh views there and then. Hockey World Cup has fetched me 1,200 views. When India's, India, aside of cricket, India does something well in other sports because space is not a constraint.
But you recall
people,
when
1,500
Sindhu,
people will watch it versus 3 lakh.
When PV Sindhu played Commonwealth at that time, she had one of the highest rated matches.
Maybe on
at the same
on the
day
when
T20
yes.
was also playing.
See, the problem is again it'll be vis-a-vis. It'll be vis-a-vis.
It's a chicken and egg. You know, the more we show, the more people play. Exactly. Any questions? We can take only one. We're running out of time.
So somebody said over here that the sports career has to be given complete priority over any other requirements, social or economical. Now, if that is the case, a person has to have a social and economic life. Now, there are people who have good career, but they have been victimized. Those who are prosperous, they have survived, but those who are not prosperous are washed out. Even we just heard the case of Mitali, and at that time, Ganguly also said that, I mean, you can see that the career is ruined because of political reasons. If this has happened to a person who needs money also to survive, what could happen? And government does not have money, as somebody has said. The question is what to do for a person who has a career but limited means.
This is where you come in.
The opinions expressed over here are quite confusing.
This is where you come in. That's what I said earlier. That you have to pick up these sportspersons.
On that note, I think what we'll do...
See, again, you're being unfair to sportspersons. Huh? Just one question.
So, it's really been about the conversation on building a new India. And I think I'm so happy to have heard a diverse set of you. Money, as the sports minister said, Mr. Rathore, there is in plenty. But all the federations have to come together, be accountable and publicly visible, and you'll see this. As the president of FICCI has said many a times, and he's an avid marathoner, the scope in front of us is very large and sometimes overwhelming. But when you're running the marathon, you're not running for 42 kilometers as an objective. You're running 1 kilometer 42 times. And that's the small, small steps that we have to keep on taking. We are also, as Indians, sometimes very content with what we achieve, right? Abhi kaha the 10 years ago and where we are now 10 years later. But I think if we are able to set our sights ahead, there is a lot of reform. We've talked about accountability for federations, we've talked about infrastructure, we've talked about ecosystem, we've talked about media having its say, and we've talked about sports as being part of mindset and not only about winning medals. A good hockey player plays where the puck is. And now, just that we've just lost our hockey qualifiers yesterday, a great hockey player plays where the puck is going to be. So on that note, we shall end. Thank you very, very much, Kirti sir, Geet, Manaji, Vidya, Deepak, and Vikrant. Thank you.